Welcome back. Today we're incredibly lucky to be joined by Renee Almeling. Renee is a professor of sociology and public health at Yale University, and she's one of the world's leading experts on the market for sperm and egg. Renee, thank you so much for joining us.
It's a pleasure to be here.
So Renee, you're an expert on the buying and selling of sperm and egg, sometimes also referred to as gametes, and we're going to talk a little bit about those two markets. And we're going to start by talking just a bit about sperm. So tell me a little about who's the typical sperm donor in America.
I mean, the average sperm donor is a college student. He's in his early 20s. He's interested in making a little bit of extra money at a job that doesn't take too much of his time. When I did interviews with sperm donors, I found that there were really two groups. There was this group of sort of younger college students. There was also a group of older men who had known somebody who experienced trouble getting pregnant or infertility. And so some of those folks had sort of put in some of their energy into being sperm donors as well.
And a lot of this is from your amazing book, Sex Sells, C-E-L-L-S, which I think is one of the best titles I've seen on the academic market. How much is a typical sperm donor paid in America?
Yeah, well, the average payment is about $100, $125 per sample. What most people don't know about sperm banks is that men go through an extensive screening process, and then they're going in at least once a week for 6 months to a year in order to earn that $100 to $125 per sample. So we have this idea that men can wake up one morning and say, oh, I'm going to go donate sperm this morning and go make 50 bucks, and that's not really how it works.
And so this screening screens out a lot of men. Any sense about like how many men get screened out? I have to say, for my class, when I taught this in a bricks and mortar class once, I tried to become a sperm donor. I was screened out. I don't know what that says about me. Am I normal to have been screened out? What kind of number of people get screened out?
Yeah, well, you're in very good company.
Thank goodness.
So about 99% of men who apply to become sperm donors will be screened out. So sperm banks are looking for men who are extremely fertile with very high sperm counts. So if you look at a sort of bell curve of fertility, they're looking for men in the top 2 to 3% of sperm count. That's because they freeze the sperm or cryopreserve it. That kills off about half the cells. So that's right there knocking out most men who apply. And then the men who make it through that test need 3 generations of their family health history to look pretty good. So men who have, you know, a lot of heart attacks or mental illness or alcoholism in their family won't make it through the screening process. And then they have to be willing to go in at least once a week for a year to make donations. And so, you know, if you have 100 men who make that first call to the sperm bank, you're really walking out the door with about 1% of the people making it through that process.
So there's a lot of screening that happens. And I know you've written your work about how men are paid. So just because I donate sperm, does that mean I automatically get paid for that donation?
No, it doesn't. So in sperm banks, men go in and they make this donation. If their sperm count is high enough to meet the bank standards, then they will be paid for that donation. But all kinds of things can cause that sperm count to drop, including being too stressed out, say by your finals in school, if you're drinking too much alcohol, if you're not getting enough rest, if you're sick. So all of these things can cause sperm count to drop. So men's sperm count, which, you know, another thing that people don't realize is men's sperm count really fluctuates over days and months. And so sperm donors have to stay pretty healthy and take good care of themselves in order to actually make that money from being a donor.
And there's also an abstinence requirement, as I understand it?
Yes. So men who donate sperm, because they need to build up that sperm count, have to be abstinent from any sort of sexual activity for about 48 hours before they go donate. So then you can start to understand how sperm donors find this a little bit onerous. They have to schedule their sex lives, they have to be mindful of their diet and their exercise. And so if they're going in to donate once a week, then they're being abstinent for 2 days before they go in. If they're trying to donate twice a week, then they're abstinent for 2 days twice a week. And some of the donors I interviewed tried to donate 3 times a week. So then they're really sort of really scheduling their sex lives in a way that many of them did find somewhat onerous.
And I should say that although we're using the term donation, and because that's the common term, as both of us have written about in our work, there's lots of controversy about whether that's the right term. Some people prefer provision, which is more neutral. Some people like to say sale, because it is kind of being compensated, at least the portion that we're talking about. And we'll keep using the word donation because it's more natural, but always good to kind of acknowledge the way in which these terms carry meaning.
It's an interesting point, and there has been a lot of debate in the literature, as you note. For me as a sociologist, I'm really really interested in how this industry thinks of itself and how it works. And so it's important to me that the term that they use is donation. And then, of course, we can sit here and say, well, you're being paid for donation, and a paid donation seems a little oxymoronic. But I think it's important to understand why they use that language, how that language functions in organizing the market, in shaping donors' experiences.
And this leads into the question about how men are recruited. So how are sperm donors recruited? What's the messaging about sperm donation? Tell me a little bit more about that.
Yeah, well, historically, sperm banks really relied on this idea that sperm donation was this easy thing. It's something that's a little bit funny. You know, they make jokes in their advertisements. And so the advertisements really focus on cartoon images of sperm. There might be some small print about helping somebody to become a family, but the focus is really on, you know, come in and get paid for something you're already doing, to quote one of the ads. So they draw on these sort of cheeky advertisements in order to recruit men in, because they're dealing with a college-age population for the most part. But donation is not really framed for men as something that is important or, you know, really contributing to the lives of others by helping them have families. The focus really is on come in and, you know, provide some sperm and get paid.
So let's talk a little bit about the way in which these men are recruited, and in particular, sort of gendered messaging in the recruitment and the conceptions of employment. And this is a really important part of your work, I know.
Really, the main argument of my book is that this language of donation suffuses both the world of egg agencies and sperm banks. But in sperm banks, a paid donation is understood as a job. They think of men as employees. They cut them paychecks every 2 weeks. They talk to them about this is something they need to show up for on a regular basis, clock in and clock out, and produce a passable sample. And in egg donation, that paid donation is really understood as a gift from one woman to another, and that it's in a gift in the service of creating a family. So even though this language of donation is similar across sperm donation and egg donation, what that donation is looks really different.
How long do men typically stay sperm donors?
You know, we actually don't have any data to answer that question. So one of the things that I think we'll probably talk about later is the fact that this market is completely unregulated in the United States. We have no idea how many donors there are, how often they donate, how many children are born. So those basic questions, we actually don't have the answers to.
And let me just emphasize that last point you said, that we don't know how many children are born. There are no regulations. So in theory, there's no limit to the number of children that could be born from a certain donor. Now, many of the clinics will say that they're responsible about this. They keep registries, although there's some question about whether people can go to more than one registry, right?
Right. Well, sperm banks do ask their clients to report back if they have a pregnancy, if they give birth to a child, so that they can keep track of how many offspring have been born per donor. But they don't have any way of enforcing that reporting. And there's also no standards or regulations for what the maximum is for that family. So we now have websites like DonorSiblingRegistry.com, where people can go and see that particular donor from a particular sperm bank has 40 offspring who have registered just with that website, or 75, or 175. So we do have some of these anecdotal reports of very large numbers of children being born from particular donors. And that, to me, is one of the major things that we do need to rectify in this market.
Yeah, one of the concerns was sometimes called accidental incest, that you might actually end up having a romantic relationship with a half-sibling at least, right?
Yeah, I think that's one of, you know, that is definitely one of the theoretical concerns that has been out there. I'm actually more concerned about the health effects, because a lot of these donors are young college students, and they may have genetic mutations that will cause disease later in life that they may not know about. And so there have been cases, such as one that was reported in the Journal of the American Medical Association, with a donor who didn't realize that he had this heart condition that was genetic. It was a heritable condition. He was a sperm donor. He had 22 children. And 6 or 7 of those kids inherited that mutation, including a toddler who died from it. So in sort of old-fashioned normal reproduction, you know, men could certainly have 2 or 5 or even, you know, 8 or 10 children. But when we ramp up the numbers, as we have with sperm donation, those unknown health risks that get passed on to a potentially much larger number of children.
And we'll actually talk about a case later in the course about a child who inherits polycystic kidney disease and tries to track down the identity of the sperm donor for that purpose.